Hi, my name is Shomini Sen. Many of you may not have heard my name before. I'm a film critic and I write extensively on cinema for various regional and national digital platforms. I don't appear on TV. I'm no Rajiv Masand or Anupama Chopra or Bharadwaj Rangan. But over the years, I have managed to find a small place in an industry where people's dreams come true. When I meet people at parties and they ask what I do for a living, I say I watch movies for a living. And most think it is a dream job to have. Sure it is. मेरे पास माँ और सिनेमा दोनों है. आई गेट टू वॉच मूवीज, डिसाइड इफ दे आर वर्थ वॉचिंग एंड बेसिकली गेट पेड टू एक्सप्रेस माई ओपिनियन. मोस्ट डेज आई लव माई जॉब. बट देन देर आर ऑल्सो डेज वेन आई फाइंड माई सेल्फ अलोन इन अ सिनेमा हॉल watching an obscure film because reviewing Friday releases is part of the job. We can't pick and choose the films we want to watch. With the onslaught of social media, feedbacks are in galore. Everyone is an armchair critic, and I have encountered innumerable people who have gotten hurt by my reviews. I'm not kidding. Take for the example, the 2019 smash hit Kabir Singh. You all have watched it, right? If not Kabir Singh, then the original Arjun Reddy you must have surely watched. Now, I have to be honest. There are very few films that would make me very angry. This was one of them. Many in the audience would right now be appalled at the idea that how could such a realistic film make me angry? But it did. And when I wrote about it in my review, I was told to go watch Toy Story. Because the trolls felt that my mental capacity was of that level. Some even declared that I have never been in love. Some said I don't understand what true love is. Well, I may or may not understand what love is in its entirety, but I do understand hitting each other in the name of affection is not love. Actually, why blame the trolls only? Some of my very educated, woke friends and colleagues too have argued that some relationships are exactly how it is depicted in the film. Those some people had also told me that some girls are manipulative, much like Sweetie from Sonu Ke T2 Ki Sweetie. I hope I got the name right. That modern day toxic relationships look something like how they showed it in Tamasha or Sonu Ke T2 Ki Sweetie or my favorite, Kabir Singh. Which makes me come to today's topic. Cinema, as they say, has always been the mirror to the society. Indian cinema has always reflected the mood of the society. Be it the time of the early 50s, 1950s, and 60s, when a newly independent India was trying to build itself, and Manoj Kumar's Deshbhakti-filled cinema captured the imagination of the audience, to the 70s, when lack of jobs, political activism, rule the society with thousands of qualified youth, somewhat close to your age, were at home unemployed, frustrated at how the state and the government had let them down and not provided jobs. That gave birth to the angry young man, and we all know who played that role to perfection. The 80s saw the rise of love stories where the man had to fight the biggest villain of them all, the girl's father. Usually, the hero would be from a poor background, while the girl would be from a rich family. Villains were almost always rich, while the hero was always from a humble background. The 90s, a time when most of you were born, was when stories shifted outside of India. NRIs had to be booed, and so many plots were based outside of the country. To now, 20 years on, where we seem to have gone back to our roots, formulating stories that are very Indian, yet with a message pertinent to the current times, like a toilet ek prem katha, which talks of sanitization, or Vicky Donor, which explores sperm donation, and IVF to Aligarh and Ek Ladki Ko Dekha To Aisa Laga, that talked of the LGBTQ community. The stories may be set in a smaller town in India, but the messaging is pertinent and universal. So you see, cinema with time has evolved. In the beginning, when talkies in India began, Mythology was almost always the theme of cinema. At that time, working in cinema was equated to prostitution. Yes. We all know that girls from good families would not act in films. First, in Raja Harish Chandra in 1913, men played women's roles. It could be also that cinema was inspired by Jatra or Natak. Do you guys know what Jatra is? It's kind of a folk theater that traveled across villages with troops performing mostly mythological stories. I'm talking about hundreds of years ago. And moving theater meant that only men traveled and women stayed home. So men ended up playing the female characters too. Cinema took inspiration from theater, which was common by then in India. I'll just show you some images. So that's Raja Harish Chandra's, still from the first film, 1913. If you can see, I'm hovering my mouse. These are the men playing women's role. We saw an Australian Mary Evans who could do stunts and lift a man, throw him across the room. She wore Zorro-like mask and used a whip. She changed her name to Nadia to adapt to Indian sensibilities and eventually came to be known as Fearless Nadia. That name stuck with her through the ages. That's Mary Evans, and that's Hunter Wali Fearless Nadia. Okay, moving on. Now, Mary Evans, of course, catapulted to huge fame. While men and women all alike revered and admired her strength and beauty, not too many were keen to send their daughters to cinema. Fearless Nadia inspired other women from abroad to try their luck in Indian cinema, including Helen, who eventually got to play vamps in cinema. Speaking of Helen, you must have recalled that how women were easily demarcated by their clothes in cinema. I'm talking of 1960s, 70s, when actresses like Asha Parekh, Sadhana played the leading actresses. Dressed in salwar kameez, saris mostly, they played coy in front of the hero, while the seductress Bindu or Helen would lure the hero with suggestive dance steps, bold outfits and outlandish wigs. You see, that was the time when cinema was slowly getting accepted in Indian middle-class households. Not entirely, but some allowed their daughters to work in cinema and they were only restricted to play the quintessential Bharatiya Nari. While the vamp was always known to be a bad moral character, hence would wear bold outfits. That's Sadhana. That's Asha Parekh, the typical Indian Bharatiya Nari, typically with saris and Indian wear. And that's Helen. Outlandish wig. You can see the attire. That's how it was. All right. Okay. Now, just to give a more recall value, imagine your grandmothers and their photos from younger days. Can any of you recall them wearing jeans and tops? The society perceived such clothes as immoral, and that's what was projected in films too. With changing times, cinema and its characters too changed. Women were seen in more realistic characters wearing more identifiable clothes. The 70s and 80s had two distinct kinds of cinema. The masala pot boilers had Amitabh Bachchan playing the angry young man. And then there was the parallel cinema, which had actors like Amol Palekar, Nasruddin Shah, Om Puri playing realistic roles, close to how the common man was basically. While parallel cinema heralded a change in how we saw the actors and stories, commercial success eluded them. Cinema lovers obviously shifted more towards Big B's masala films, which are dialogue baze, action, romance, hit songs. Why not? I mean, of course, that's more attractive. The 90s was the time when Shah Rukh, Salman and Aamir Khan rose to superstardom and wooed the NRI audience, especially after the success of DDLJ. I hope you all have watched that film. The film came out in 95 and its success made way for two things: big family dramas and foreign locales. Most films talked of parampara, most films were love stories with a family drama as a background, and most were shot outside of India. Dilwale Dulhaniya Le Jayenge's story was set in London and talked about the Indians and their love for their motherland. most makers copy the same formula, the slight alteration, of course, of in stories. If the story was not based in some foreign land, the songs would definitely be shot in Switzerland. Again, the idea was to project cinema as larger than life and to woo the audience to make them dream. So many people of my generation grew up romanticizing to the idea of dancing in snow-capped mountains, clad in chiffon saris, and singing romantic ballads to Shah Rukh Khan. Thank God those dreams never came true. We would have all got pneumonia by then. That's the iconic pose of DDLJ that I think everybody knows of. And that's the snow-capped mountain, if you can make out in the background, some European place where these two are romancing. Things changed, thankfully, in the early 2000s, and I give credit to two filmmakers for that. Debutant director Farhan Akhtar made a college buddy film called Dil Chahta Hai, which released in 2000, and Anurag Kashyap's much controversial Black Friday, which released in 2004. Both films were distinct, very distinct from each other. One talked of a group of friends in South Bombay, while the other was based on a series of gory bomb blasts that rocked Bombay in 1993. But it's the treatment of the two films that I feel changed the way cinema is now made. One was high on aesthetics and looks. Dil Chahta Hai made its actors look very stylish, but regular, ordinary people. And there was really wasn't any villain in the film. Just like talking, you know, life taking its own course. Meanwhile, Black Friday was dark, grim, and told the incidents that led to the 93 blast as it is, without really mincing words. These two films changed the way filmmakers approach cinema. From the non-linear way the two films narrated the stories to the characterizations, which made the two films stand out. In Dil Chahta Hai, the three friends do not promise each other their lives. No one was giving up Jaan for their dosti. That's something that has been pelted for centuries in Hindi cinema. Dil Chahta Hai changed that. In Black Friday, the interrogation scenes was as dark and grim as it is in real life. No mincing words or in this case, screenplay. The two films made way for much similar sort of films in similar genres, exploring the idea of friendship without the unreal over-dramatic expectations of dealing with a younger man falling in love with an older woman, or of basically basing a story on real-life crime incidents. Basically, giving the audience a taste of how society is, real and flawed. Of course, cinema has also served as an inspiration in real life in too many occasions. From fashion, to taking a stand against ills like dowry, to even bank robberies, styled much like a film's plot. We have come across news snippets that seem straight out of a blockbuster film. I know Dhoom, which released in 2004, inspired at least two robberies of similar kind. Then in 2016 in West Delhi, a couple much like Bunty and Bubbly burgled houses posing as beauticians. Cinema has that power too. It is of course upon us as audience to hold cinema accountable. Much like cinema holds a mirror to our ever-evolving society, we too should hold artists and cinema in general accountable for what they depict on screen, because the impact that cinema holds on any of us is unmatched. In recent years, the advent of OTT has shrunk the world. Who would have thought that we would be sitting at home in Delhi and watching Super Deluxe from the comforts of our home, or a Korean Parasite for that matter? OTT has brought about massive change, and I think that's for the better, of course. It has opened up the world to stories that many a times Bollywood shies away from speaking about, like The Great Indian Kitchen. I don't know how many of you have watched it. It's highly recommended. I can't imagine a Hindi film with an established star cast creating a film that is so impactful as this one. And I only relied on subtitles while watching the film. I spoke to Malayalam actor Fahad Fasil a few months back, and he attributed the growing prominence of nuclear families as also one of the major factors that has made OTT such a success. With smaller families, their freedom to watch individualistic content is also far greater. OTTs may have brought the world to laptops and phones, but I also think the magic of cinema will never fade away. It of course doesn't take away the larger than life image of Indian cinema. Filmmakers continue to date to make big budget unrealistic films, but also balance it out with thought-provoking cinema. So for every coolie number one, there is a thappar, and for every houseful, there will be an Article 15. We will just learn how to coexist, much like we have been able to in the pandemic, steering away from the virus, the trash, taking in what's appealing to us at that time. That's it from me, everyone. See you at the movies.